recording now. Okay, so welcome everyone. Like I said, this is our third session of the Standing Side by Side Parent Sex Education Series. And tonight's topic is media literacy and pornography, which is a fun one and a challenging one. And so we're really excited to be here with you all tonight to talk about this hot topic with you all. So my name is Leslie Massicott, and I use she or they pronouns, and I am coming from the Compass Center. And my colleague, Montserrat, is here today as well. So I will let her introduce herself.
Hello, everyone. I'm here helping Leslie with a presentation, and I am excited to share some information with you all today.
Awesome. So just a quick thing about the Compass Center. Ooh, someone's figured out how to mark up my slides, which I love. I don't even know how to get that off. So good job for you. So pardon the red marks on there, but we are coming from the Compass Center. So we're a domestic violence agency in Chapel Hill. And part of our services is doing violence prevention work. And what that means for me and Montserrat is we actually go into schools and do sex education because we believe that sex education is a key piece of violence prevention. And so we're excited to be offering this series for parents. And so welcome to new folks who have not joined us for previous sessions. We do have the other session recordings available, and I will send those out in the follow-up email after this session today. So what are we going to talk about today? We will be looking at media literacy and trying to understand what it is exactly and why it's important. And then Montserrat will introduce us to a four-question model to identify some of those underlying messages of mainstream media images. And this is going to set us up really well to dive into pornography as a specific form of media. And so we will then define pornography, talk about what it is, the different types of porn out there. Do not worry, we will not be showing any porn tonight. I do not plan to do that. We're just going to be talking about what it is and look at some of the statistics of young people's interaction with porn. And then a lot of the time today, we'll be getting and sharing tips on talking with the young people in your life about media literacy and porn. So I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Montserrat to start us in on media literacy.
Thank you so much, Leslie. Okay, so starting off, I just want to ask everyone, what is media literacy to you all? What does that mean? And you can feel free to unmute. You can use the hand feature to unmute, or you can type it in the chat. So what is media literacy to you all? What does it mean to be media literate, or why is it important? So understanding the intent of types of media, that's fairly spot on. We see familiarity with all different formats of content. Consuming media and being able to understand it. Yeah, the messages and the intent. So there's always going to be intent behind media and what we're seeing. And being able to verify and fact check, that's a very big and very big part of it, as we've seen, you know, just going through this past year and all the type of information that we can see online. That's a good point. So media literacy is defined as the ability to identify different types of media and the messages that they are sending. So a lot of the media that we see isn't just a pretty image. It's not just a pretty scene. There's always going to be some kind of message or some information that is being shared. And Amy mentions also the entertainment aspect of it, right? So the main reason why we always see these things and that they're eye-catching is because they're entertaining. Okay, so to start us off with this model, whenever we're looking at media or when we're trying to teach our students and our kids to see media in a way that is constructive, the first step that we want to consider is we want to have them think about who created this image and scene or why. So thinking about you know, this is very important for also our second step. So when we think about who created this image, we can kind of start to think about what the message is that's being sent out. So depending on who's creating the image or the scene, is going to clue us in into the message that's being sent. The third step would be what values are being portrayed. So we want to ask ourselves, what are we being taught right now? What is this trying to portray to us as far as values? You know, what is something that we're going to walk away knowing from this? And lastly, you want to think about who or what is left out and why. So a big thing that I like to point out with this step is, you know, who is in the scene, who's in the image. Does that impact the message in some way? Does it change our understanding of the message? You know, it kind of, all of these all come together and come to, you know, build up this critical learning and critical thinking that we are trying to instill in our kids so that they can take images and media and not take them at face value, you know, thinking deeply into them and what it is that the messages are that are being sent out. So I'm going to post some examples. We're going to look at some examples here together. So this first example, I want to see if anyone has any ideas about who created this image and why. We're going to go ahead and deconstruct this this media image. So if you could go ahead and unmute or put in the chat any ideas about who created this image and why. So we see a perfume company there. It's an agency trying to sell a product. Mm-hmm. So there's this goal of selling the product, right? They don't just want you to know about it. They want you to want to buy it. Mm-hmm. Trying to sell a fragrance. Mm-hmm. So with them trying to sell this fragrance and trying to get people to buy it, what message is being sent by the construction of this media? Thinking about, you know, the people that we see on the image, the body language, what message is being sent here? What do you guys think? You are sexy if you use it, right? So they're trying to push this idea that there is some sexual ideas being pushed into it. So your wildest dreams will come true. You'll be wanted sexually if you wear this perfume. So it's pushing out the ideas also about gender identity, right? That if you are a woman and you want to be sexually desirable, you will use this perfume, or vice versa, that we have a male in the image as well. If you want to be sexually desirable as a male, then you would use this perfume. Celebrity endorsement as well, yes. And they're using that instinct and the animal print to try to reel us in, right? Get our attention with this ad. Open your shirt and see my pecs. Yes. So again, that sexuality aspect is being pushed onto us. And we want to think about what values are being portrayed. So that kind of goes along with the message being sent. So we're thinking about, you know, heavy emphasis on sexuality. It's all about appealing sexually, right, Melissa? That's true. And thinking about who or what is left out and why. Why would they choose these two individuals as opposed to other individuals? Oh, I like that one. Sex is instinctual and animalistic as far as the values go. Yeah, that's something that we could be teaching people through this ad. Beautiful people, thin and white people. That's a good point. There's, you know, what about people that don't look like these two individuals, right? This is representing a very small portion of the population. It's not necessarily inclusive. It's limiting, right? So now onto our second ad here. We're gonna do the same thing. We wanna deconstruct it, thinking first about who created this image. It was very similar to the first ad, right? Yeah, so we have Jimmy Choo trying to sell this perfume to us. He's trying to get people to, or they're trying to get people to purchase this perfume. And when we think about this ad in particular, what message is being sent? Thinking about his body language, you know, the name of the perfume. It's all about the man and only body parts of the woman, right? Her head is cut off. We don't know her identity. We don't know anything about her. We know that she, you know, her body is what's being on display here. And she's perched on his shoulder, right? And he has a firm grip on her leg. So he's in control. Yeah, that's a good point as well. In the other ad where we saw that the woman was more pushed up against the corner, right? And like in this scene, the woman is perched on his shoulder. She has no identity. All her focus is on her body. She is objectified in this ad. So what values are being portrayed along with this message? What could people learn from this ad? Masculinity, right? Melissa has a good point. So we're learning what it is to be a man, right? Jimmy Choo is saying, if you're a man, you're in control. You're stoic. You have your emotions under control. Yeah, men should dominate women. Women are irrelevant. That might be something we can learn from this ad, is that they're trying to push this value of, you know, being a man, being masculine is being strong, being dominant. Yeah, you'll be a man just like Jon Snow on this ad. So this kind of goes along with who or what is left out. So the woman is left out mostly. You know, this isn't an ad for perfume for men, but when we think about identities as masculine identities, you know, it's very limiting, right? In the diversity it's trying to present. It's only her body from the chest down. And it limits masculinity as well. That's a very good point, Leslie. So, you know, not all men look this way. Not all men choose to present their masculinity this way. That's a good point. So this third ad here is an Invincible Nike Pro ad. So we know that Nike is who created this image. We want to think about why they created this image. What is it that they're trying to convey to the consumer? Men are aggressive, strength. Yeah, so you can see that he's in this stance where he's kind of showcasing his muscles, right? You know, his athletic gear is fairly tight on his body, and he is showing himself as strong. Black man is aggressive. Yeah, there is an element of race into this as well. You know, what does it mean that they're portraying this stereotype and this, you know, this idea of the angry black man, or, you know, in when we think about sports as well. You can almost be like a Marvel superhero, right? So we're portraying masculinity as being a superhero, invincible, but we also want to think about how that also limits masculinity, right? There's, you know, a lot of men who don't necessarily want to be super muscular, men that don't want to be athletes as well. What are they selling? It's not very clear, honestly. It might be, you know, their clothing for athletes, but also we want to think, you know, invincible athletes, you know, there's also female athletes that can be strong, can present this image, probably alongside this gentleman, but, you know, they did try to focus here. Mm-hmm. All right. So what values do you think we might learn from this ad? Being the strongest. Yeah, there might be maybe some competitive values being added onto this. You know, athletes and in sports might be competitive in nature, but any other ideas? Right. You have to be invincible and win. That's a good point. To set yourself apart. That's a good point. The others are very far away from the shot. You know, he is in the forefront. Men should not be weak, right? We're being taught that men, you know, cannot show any weakness and should only, you know, show emotion when it is in regards to their strength, to winning. Very animalistic, correct? Yeah, so we see this kind of typically almost, this is almost very, very capturing the masculinity aspect of it. Right, good job. So going on to our next slide, here we're gonna show kind of just how early on, you know, media is trying to instill values into you know, general public. So we're gonna watch a short clip from this video.
You've got it, sweet cakes. No more talking, singing, zip.
But without my voice, how can I?
You'll have your looks, your pretty face. And don't underestimate the importance of body language. Ha! The men up there don't like a lot of blabber. They think a girl who gossips is a bore. Yes, on land it's much preferred for ladies not to say a word. And after all, dear, what is idle prattle for? Come on, then, not all that impressed with conversation. True gentlemen avoid it when they can. But they dote in swoon and fawn on a lady who's withdrawn. It's she who holds her tongue who gets a man. Come on, you!
All right, so what did we see in this? In this short clip, what are some of the values that we caught in that clip? So she's singing to Ariel, she's telling her what it is that is important versus not important. So men don't want women to speak, yeah. Men like women's bodies and not their voices. Right, so there's, yeah, so the villain is the one who's saying this, right? So the idea that the woman is mostly sought after for her body and not her voice or what she has to say, her thoughts, her ideas, and she won't have anything worth hearing. So a lot of the times these kinds of messages are in media and, you know, especially, you know, children's cartoons as well will often have these kinds of messages. She can achieve her goals using her body. Right. Right. These are all really good points. And so it kind of brings us back to, you know, media is entertainment. So this was a Disney movie. It is intended to entertain our young children. It's conveying certain values and points of view. So as we heard earlier, it is the villain that's saying this. So, you know, it might have something to do with trying to convey values and different different ideas from different people. You know, it's because she's not the only character in the movie. Created for money or power, it's interpreted differently for each person. So everything that is media is going to be interpreted differently for different people. And it's up to us to try to give those tools to deconstruct media and to understand what the messages are in media for, you know, our young kids. Designed to catch your attention as well. So it is designed to be entertaining. It's designed to leave an impact on us. So the messages that we receive from these media can shape how we establish our values and our ideals. And some of the stereotypes, you know, even what we saw in our last clip, can translate into adult media as well.
So that is an excellent segue into our next section, because those tools that Montserrat just walked us through are going to be incredibly, incredibly helpful for when pornography becomes, pornography exposure becomes a thing, right? And so you can use a lot of those same, if we start the journey early about really critiquing and getting thoughtful about the media that we are consuming, we encourage our kids to do that starting very young. They can already be prepared leading up to the age of when they could be potentially exposed to pornography. So they already have some of those tools in their toolbox. So if this does happen to them. And so we're going to kind of dive into looking at what is pornography? What does that encompass? So when I say pornography, what comes to mind for folks? Okay, so videos of people having sex, nude images potentially, yeah. Nude people having sex, yeah. Violent sex sometimes, A very distorted view on sex, yeah. Unrealistic sex as well. Yeah, so the definition that we're going to be using is the depiction of erotic behavior for the purpose of sexual pleasure. And so there are actually different types of pornography, which I think is helpful to point out. So a lot of the porn that we access just by typing in certain kinds of phrases into the Google search bar, that is mainstream porn. Right? That is just what we are, it's freely available, it's easy to access, it's mainstream, right? But there are also other types of porn out there, including ethical porn and feminist porn. And so ethical porn does a lot better in terms of providing fair wages for its performers. They also provide safer working conditions for their employees. And so in a lot of mainstream porn, you don't see an emphasis on safe sex, on protection, on consent, on things like that. And in ethical porn, there's a lot more emphasis on safety, right? And working conditions that, or like the consent of performers. And in ethical porn also, they often will give the performers the choice for what kinds of activities they want to engage in. And in a lot of mainstream porn, actors are not given that opportunity. They feel like they have to do whatever in order to get the job and in order to keep the job and things like that. And feminist porn is another offshoot of porn as well that was striving to, combat this idea in mainstream porn that a lot of it was designed for the male gaze, right? It was designed with male pleasure at its center. And while we do see the numbers of, in terms of viewers, the gender of viewers is pretty even between man and woman. But a lot of it is kind of geared just specifically towards male pleasure. And there's a lot of emphasis on the man, right? And so feminist porn came out of that to also encourage some of those fair wages and labor practices that I mentioned from ethical porn, but to also really show female pleasure, right? And to show folks with marginalized identities without fetishizing them, making them, an exotic thing, right? Showing more authentic experiences of orgasm and intimacy and things like that. So unfortunately, however, what our young people are most likely accessing is this mainstream porn, right? And this is, where Pornhub, WebTube, all these just freely accessible sites with no attention to safety or ethics for the most part. And so something that I like to emphasize with my students, with everyone, is this idea that porn is entertainment, right? Not education. But unfortunately, young people are using it as sex education. And that is where it's a huge issue, right? Is when, if we're using this entertainment, this media that's constructed, that's, you know, built for power and money and is not emphasizing safety, then, and that's what our kids are learning about what sex is and what it looks like. They're not getting the real facts of like how it authentically can look and how to be safe about it and how to make sure that they are not getting into situations where they, you know, there's violence or they feel like their consent is not there, right? And so I want to dive into some of the statistics because some young people are intentionally seeking out pornography and others are unintentionally exposed. And so we're going to kind of talk about different ways to handle both of those situations. So in terms of some statistics, and this was from an article that was published in the Journal of Sex Research recently, 40% of teens reported exposure to sexually explicit content. So this is folks before they turn 19, so 18 and under, 40% of them have been exposed to sexually explicit content. And if you look at like the media, like the ads that Montserrat was showing, I mean, to some that could be, you know, approaching more kind of, maybe not exactly, but I could show you some other ones that are even more pornographic than what I showed you, right? And so what does it mean, sexually explicit content, right? But this could encompass a lot of different things, but 40% is pretty high, right? So 70% of adolescents have been unintentionally exposed. And this percentage is so high and scary, honestly, that it is this high. And so we'll talk about how to kind of manage that, right? When porn is just so easily accessible these days and what that means and how we can how we can navigate that, basically. And then 52% of teens ages 12 to 15 said that parents are the ones who most influence their sexual decision-making. And the reason I like to include this is because a lot of parents think that it's actually media or it's actually peers or, you know, other people in their lives. But according to this survey, it was actually like half of the teens surveyed were said that like, no, I'd rather my parents talk to me about this kind of stuff and tell me and like help guide me, right? They really look to you all as their, you know, as their parents to help them make some of these choices about their sexual behaviors. And then the average age of first exposure is 13 years old. Although some studies do say that this could be as young as 11, which is also kind of a scary statistic, especially because, you know, back in my day and perhaps back in others' days, it was not nearly this accessible, right? And so this access is happening younger and younger. So let's talk about how we can manage that, right? But first let's talk about, so why are they watching porn in the first place? Why do you think some of them are seeking it out? Yeah, curiosity is a huge one, right? I kind of talked about them using it as sex education, right? They want to know, as Heidi says. They want to know how to do things and they don't really have examples of what it looks like or what they should do and how they should do it, right? Other friends tell them about it. And so there's kind of a peer pressure aspect to it potentially. Yeah, absolutely. Hearing from their peers, pushing boundaries and knowing it's not okay to do. Mm-hmm. It gives them a happy feeling, right? It makes them feel good. Like some teens are also masturbating, you know, touching themselves for pleasure while watching this. And so they're learning about kind of how their body's responding. It makes them feel good. They learn about their bodies as well, right? Exactly. It's like a secret. So they want to know more. So there's kind of that like, that desire, or that thrill for doing something that's secretive or taboo. And, you know, so there's that piece as well. Yeah, absolutely. But then, so what are some of the messages though that they are potentially learning from? Specifically, I'm talking about mainstream porn because I'm pretty sure they're not accessing the other stuff. So what messages are they learning from mainstream porn? Okay, so one message they might be learning is that sex is not about relationships and monogamy or safety, right? That like having a sexual relationship with someone is the way that they're seeing it in porn, right? That it's not about safety. There's no talk about safe sex or intimacy between the partners, right? They might be learning that the female partner's pleasure is not important, right? I said that mainstream porn is very, you know, has a huge emphasis on the male gaze. And so it's all about the man getting the pleasure from the woman, right? And women faking orgasms and things like that for the pleasure of the man, right? They might learn that it's okay to harm women, right? Especially when they're seeing, you know, more violent scenes in pornography, and not being able to differentiate between ones that are consensual and ones that are not, right? Yeah, so they might be learning violence against women, right? And harm to women. That sex ends with male ejaculation is something else they might learn. Absolutely, right? That it's, again, it's all about the man having a good time, you know, finishing, and then it's over, right? What someone who is desirable should look like, absolutely. So let's talk about the bodies that they are seeing on screen, right? Who are actors and actresses and people who, you know, really make their image, you know, their image look perfect. And if, you know, we can even extend that to genitals too, right? Genitals look exactly a certain way on camera as well in porn. And so they think that, well, if mine don't look like that, then I must be not normal, or must be something wrong with me, right? They might also be learning that the expected female sexual reactions are really overblown, right? Because there's a lot of that faking of the orgasms, right? And the loud noises and the screaming and the you know, all this stuff, or even like the dirty talk that, you know, that is being yelled out and all of this. Absolutely. So there are a lot of concerning messages that they could be learning. One more in there. They may be learning about boundary pushing as far as consent, right? In terms of like family relationships. So like things that focus on like hot stepsister or hot mom or like all these different things, and not learning what consent looks like, and you know, being like pounced on by a man is hot and sexy, right? And that we know that is not consensual. That's not the case, right? Absolutely. So there are definitely some challenges with some concerns about the messages that they are learning. So let's talk about how then to talk about this. Like, how do we know that there are some concerns, we know there are challenges, we kind of understand why they're looking at it though, and why, you know, also that they might be unintentionally exposed, but how do we actually talk about it, and how do we bring it up and prepare our kids and make sure that they are staying safe, right? So we're really going to look at how you can evaluate these messages, right? And so we're going to be drawing on those media literacy tools that Montserrat outlined, and encourage though that media literacy education to happen young, so that you already can just continue that into, you know, when they hit an age where they might be potentially exposed, right, to something like pornography. So some general tips that we like to share first is just about how to be an askable parent. And that matters so much when we talk about pornography or anything related to sex and sexuality. Becoming an askable parent is huge, because then they know that they can trust you as someone that they can go to if they are hurt or they're scared or they have a question and they don't know what, you know, they don't know what they're seeing, and they want to talk about it with somebody. And so part of being an askable parent is beginning these talks early. So using media, you know, like the second you start opening books, or the second you start giving them, you know, like allowing them to have screen time, they're engaging in media literacy, right? Or like they're getting exposed to media. So media literacy can begin super early. Bringing it up and not pushing it can be key, right? See what questions they have that they are bringing up. And then communicate your values also. Make sure that you have taken the time to really think about what is important to me, what do I want to convey, what is important to our family, what do I want my kids to know about these things, and checking in with your own reactions, right? And like, oh, I'm like that, you know, the fact that they came to me or they did this thing or whatever it was, I'm finding that I react in a really strong way. And how can we navigate that and try to make sure we check our initial reaction, so we can then make sure we continue to be an askable parent and don't shut them down from talking to you further, right? I see in the chat, it came up with my son because it was mentioned as a joke Yeah, in a movie. So we discussed it right there. Perfect, right? I'm always saying use media. Like, it's all around us all the time, and it allows you to have this, you know, stepping off point, jumping off point to talk about so many different things, including porn, right? So a rape joke was in there. And so, yeah, and not that it was easy, of course not, Melissa, right? These are still hard conversations, but how to start that conversation can feel like the hardest. And media gives you, unfortunately, often so many opportunities for us to bring it up, right? So taking a pause in that movie and having that conversation can be great. Making sure that you're listening to, you know, being an askable parent is really listening to what your kids are saying, and avoiding preaching at the same time, right? Not wanting to just tell them this is how it is, you know, but be like, what did you think about that? What, how are you feeling? Practicing non-judgment, like I said, checking your own reactions, using everyday activities, being honest, like they deserve to know, right? And also it's okay not to know. You're not always going to know the answer when it comes to sexuality and porn, and that's okay. So know how you can get support, know some resources, which I'll point you to here in a second, of ways that you can find more information, and, you know, look things up together if you don't know the answer. So like I said, you know, talking about porn may feel scary, but revisit these four questions, right? Revisit the four question media literacy tool that we introduced at the beginning. Who created this image or scene and why? What message is being sent? What values are portrayed, and who or what is left out? And you'll notice that all of those questions, you know, they matter when you think about pornography. And those are the kinds of questions we want our kids to be asking if and when they are exposed to pornographic images, right? Or scenes, is, you know, this is not real, right? This is, you know, these are actors, and this is entertainment, right? Some of those same things that we saw before. So you can use that same tool for exploring pornography as well. And what is interesting about the topic of pornography is that you actually have the opportunity to talk about so many different topics when you discuss porn. Right? You can be talking about bodies, you know, what bodies look like, what anatomy is okay, what is not normal, things like that, relationships, gender roles, safe sex, consent, all these different things. Howie asked in the chat, does this information get taught to kids like when Compass Center visits schools? I wish. it's not included in our curriculum. And so that is something that we have a curriculum that we teach, and it is not included. It's mostly HIV and STI and pregnancy prevention. I think the health teacher, it depends on the health teacher, honestly, how much media literacy education they get. And so I wish that I could say we could rely on these conversations happening in school, but for a number of different reasons, they might not be. So that's why it's important as parents that we also know how to have these conversations, so we can supplement what they are learning at school or add in what they are, you know, they're not learning. Yeah, absolutely. Oh, and Jenna shares that there's a little bit of media literacy in the Orange County Rape Crisis Center Start Strong curriculum. That's awesome to know as well. So Orange County Rape Crisis Center, who typically they co-facilitate this presentation with me, they also are in the schools as well. And so it looks like they do some media literacy then. So they do a little bit, but not porn, I'm pretty sure. Jenna, clarify if I'm wrong, but but I think that's great to hear that there is some media literacy at least. And so part of this is determining when it's okay, or like, when is it time to talk to your kid? And these are some guidelines that are great to think about. Like, is it time to bring this up, right? If they haven't brought it up already to me, is it time, right? So think about these considerations when you're trying to figure that out. Does your child use smartphones or the internet without adult supervision? If they are, it's probably time, right? Do they attend school or go on play dates outside the home? So maybe you don't need to have the porn talk, but maybe you need to have at least the media literacy talk, depending on how old they are, right? Do they consume mainstream media? Again, we talked about how like young that starts. Do they have older siblings, friends, or close relatives where they could potentially be unintentionally exposed? Do they ask questions about sexual health? Are they getting curious about certain things? And so kind of a general rule, general hint, I guess, if you're wondering if it's time, it probably is, as scary as that, you know, feels perhaps. But again, start easy with the media literacy pieces and get those skills down, and then it'll be more of an easy transition to move into talking about explicit sexual images. Okay. So one phrase that I will offer is this phrase: I want you to come to me if you ever see something that makes you feel uncomfortable so we can talk about it. And this is some language that can be helpful for you to start some conversations. You know, after you've processed some TV show or some statement someone made in a show that you're watching, or you're processing a lyric that you heard them singing, and you're like, do you know what that means? you could also use this phrase, right? I want you to come to me if you ever see something that makes you feel uncomfortable so we can talk about it. Now, how do you actually talk about it? I'm going to quickly go through some resources for you of some tools that you can use to start these conversations and actually talk about porn specifically. And so you don't have to rush and write things down or screenshot or anything. I will be sending these out after, so you will have a copy of these that you can refer to at the end of this. So the first is that amaze.org is a great website that has tons of videos for elementary and middle school age kids. Specifically, they do have some that are for high school as well. You'll just have to kind of check depending on your kid and what you think, you know, they will think is not too silly, basically. But they have a great one called Porn Fact or Fiction. And this helps them get this idea that porn is fictional, right? It's not realistic, it's entertainment, right? It's media, right? So that's a great starting point. There's also a Become an Askable Parent podcast, which is really great. And it's also from Amaze. And episode 9 is on the topic of how to talk about porn. And it's by a really wonderful person named Melissa Pinter Carnegie. And they run Sex Positive Families, which is another really great resource that I think I have on here next. Yep. So sexpositivefamilies.com. If you honestly just type in porn at the search bar, you'll have tons of resources on their website that you can use to bring up this topic. They also have a monthly newsletter that they send out via email that you can sign up for. I don't have kids yet. I hope to one day, but I get these monthly e-newsletters and they're excellent. And they give me all the tips and tools to feel prepared. And they also offer workshops specifically that you can sign up for as well. And then there's a podcast called the 6-Minute Sex Ed Podcast, which is great because it's a tool that you can actually listen to with your kids. And they have level 1 episodes and level 2 episodes. So level 1 is for younger ages, like pretty simple, pretty basic stuff, like in elementary school. And then level 2 gets into more complex themes. And so episode 15, there's a general, let's talk about porn for older youth. And episode 41 talks about revenge porn. And those are just the two that I found just kind of browsing. So that's another really great option to, you know, just really sit down with your kid and listen to this together and have a chat about it. There are also some great books. Sexploitation is a great one. Real Talk About Sex and Consent is a great one as well. And then Sex Positive Families just came out with a great book that I actually just purchased myself as well. It's also excellent. Sex Positive Talks to Have with Kids. And these are chock full of really great tools as well. So I'm going to turn it back over to Monstra. And given all that you've learned, we've given you some tools, we've given you a snapshot of some resources, we are going to see, we're going to have you practice a little bit. So I will turn it back over to Monstra.
Okay, so we have a couple of scenarios here and that we're going to go through. So these are scenarios that are very plausible to happen. They might have already happened to you all, but we're going to go ahead with the first one. So you walk into your child's room one night and see them looking at porn. They immediately close their laptop and both of you are clearly caught off guard, but it's important to you to have a conversation about it. What might you say to your child? So what would you guys do in this situation? Kind of start brainstorming in the chat, or you can unmute as well. Oh, what might we do first if we were in a situation?
Or what have you done in the past? Maybe this has happened.
Scream, just kidding. Yeah, so it is uncomfortable, right? So this is a situation that you know, both of us, both of you would be caught off guard. It's not really something that you, either of you planned. So we see, hey kiddo, sorry I walked in without knocking. I noticed you closed your lap, your computer quickly. Let's talk about why that was. Hey, I saw you were looking at porn. Let's talk about that. Right. So we want to kind of address it, right? Probably not in the moment. You know, it might be a little bit awkward for your child. Maybe let them know, you know, we're not in trouble. I want to talk to you about this maybe later. You know, if you want to come down to the living room and have a chat with me, then that might be a good starting point, you know. You want to make sure that your child isn't still, you know, doing what they were doing while they were watching porn. Emphasis on curiosity. Yeah. So we want to know that you know, they are curious to learn about sexuality, about explicit content. It's not necessary to hide anything from me. Right. Right. So we want to be open. We want to be askable parents, you know, not shaming them for what it is that they're witnessing or what it is that they're looking at. Come from a place of compassion, because it's not a fair situation. Yeah, so this is a very different situation than a lot of us had growing up, right? So a lot of this media is easily accessible through the internet, and you know, younger ages are having access to the internet compared to other generations. And that might not necessarily be a bad thing, but it is something that we have to take into account. Let's talk about this so I can make sure you're being safe, right? So what are they looking at? What it is that they might be learning or as far as safety goes, right? Some things, especially if we are talking about a child with a vulva, you know, there's a lot of porn out there that might showcase, you know, different household items being utilized as sex toys. And we want to also make sure that they're being safe about what it is that they're doing to their bodies, right? So those are some good suggestions. This is our second scenario here. So you ask your child if you can use their phone since you cannot locate your own. Happens to us all the time. When you open the browser, you see there's a tab open with a porn website. Your child doesn't realize what you saw and you know they'll be embarrassed. How do you have a conversation about it? Slightly different from the last scenario. So your child doesn't know immediately that you are aware of what they're browsing on the internet. How would we start off this conversation? So when we think about this, you know, it is a personal cell phone. We want to kind of be a little bit more thoughtful about how we go into it, because we don't want them to feel that we are in, you know, breaching their privacy or things of that nature. Hey, I'd like to talk about what I found on your phone. You're not in trouble, right? So a lot of the times when we initiate these kinds of conversations and we say, I want to talk about what we saw, and especially if they know that pornography and explicit content is something that they're hiding, generally speaking, that kind of language might set them off. It might make them a little bit nervous, right? Make them think that they're in trouble. It starts with how others can access what we look up on our phones, right? It's not as private as we might think. So thinking about privacy, right? We don't want our children to think that they're, you know, in the safety blanket, when the reality is that they're not. You know, there's a lot of ways for information that's on our phone to be exposed. And we want to also kind of go through that information. Right, utilizing our resources that we shared. I like to watch this video from amaze.org and hear your thoughts about it. So we can use these resources, right, to help us and guide us, and we can use them with our kids as well, so that we can both learn, right? Let them know that this is the situation where we're working on it together. You know, it's not necessarily preaching. It is you know, it's uncomfortable for us, but it's important for both of us to go through this and to have this conversation so that, you know, if there ever is a situation where you might feel unsafe, you might feel uncomfortable, that you feel like you can come and talk to me about it, right? So going on to the third scenario here. Your child is playing video games online with their friends on the family computer. They get linked with a porn website in the chat by a random user and they click on it. You hear the audio from the other room and go investigate. How do you respond? So we saw earlier that there are a lot of parents here with kids who might participate in online gaming, which as quarantine and the pandemic has kind of almost opened that door up for a lot of kids. And so this is a situation where they are unintentionally exposed to porn, right? So they didn't look for this. They weren't snooping around or trying to find out about sex. It was unintentional. So how would we respond to this kind of behavior? I think we can kind of start to think about the last scenario, right? Where we start to think about, you know, technology and about how, you know, clicking on links that are being sent to them by strangers online without knowing necessarily what they may contain seems to be just generally some information they'd like to know that they can get those tools to avoid doing that in the future, you know, as far as ads go, scams, things like that. Hey, what are you watching? I want to process that with you after you're done with your game. You're not in trouble. So always reiterating that you're not in trouble. You know, we want to be an askable parent. We don't really want to shame them, especially in a situation like this where they, you know, they might be afraid, right? They might be confused. They weren't expecting, you know, what might have popped up. All right, in this last scenario, your child is watching a show with their friends and they come across a sexually explicit scene. They're confused about what's happening and they continue to watch out of curiosity. What would you advise? So we saw this kind of in the chat earlier with Melissa, right? Where this, the topic of porn popped up as a joke on a movie, right? So this is slightly different from that, but there's a sexually explicit scene in a movie and, you know, they're curious and they're watching what's happening. What do you think might be the first steps to talking about it in this scenario? And pause and have a conversation, right? As we saw. So in the moment, trying to open that conversation up, you know, we're using media as a conversation starter. Start to talk about what's happening. You know, depending on the explicit scene, you could go into relationship topics, into consent, body image, different kinds of topics, right? And they're all equally important to talk about. This has also happened and he covered his face and I felt bad that I let him watch a show that this could happen, but it made us have a conversation about it not being appropriate / realistic and not necessary to show the relationship, right? So that's important. So relationship values and also how realistic it is depending on the scene, right? So especially not necessary to show their relationship. You know, a lot of young kids, their lives are basically tracked through media and a lot of things are posted on social media. And it's a good point about it's not necessary to show every aspect of your relationship. Sometimes maybe it is an intimate space, right?
So I believe that brings us up to time, but we're so glad that you all were able to join us. And just know that a lot of you have the tools, you know, many of you already have the tools available to you to talk about this. It's just kind of gaining that confidence in actually bringing it up. And so we are gonna let you go. We're gonna put a feedback form in the chat. If you wouldn't mind doing that, we'll also send it in the email. We'd love to just hear what you all thought. And please do join us for our last session on May 13th. It's my birthday, actually. So come help me celebrate my birthday by talking about LGBTQ identities and also how to prevent homophobic bullying. So thanks so much, everyone, for attending. And we hope to see you next time. Take care.
Thank you all.